Sunday, all of us are in the city of Bombay. The summer season is quite intense, but still all of you in such large numbers have come to the temple to take darshan of Shri Radha Gopinath, and also giving me an opportunity to glorify the Supreme Lord and his devotees in some small way. So I'm really grateful to all of you. Last week I returned from a small yatra to South India. We had been with a group of devotees to South India. And as a preparation for that yatra, I had prepared something related to some of the events that happened there. And it's very nourishing, very nice. So we have decided to discuss the same thing with all of you. Just like in our parampara, before Lord Chaitanya appeared, in the land of Navadvip, there was Advaita Acharya, there was Srivas Pandit, Mukunda, Sanjay, and all of them were longing for the appearance of the Lord. And then, in reciprocation to their fervent appeals, the Supreme Lord appeared. Similarly, in the south of India, one very famous tradition of Vaishnavism is the Sri Vaishnavas. So Sri Vaishnavas are those Vaishnavas who are connected to the Supreme Lord's teachings through Lakshmi Devi. In South India, she is called Sri Devi. And the most prominent Acharya in this line is Sripad Ramanujacharya. But before this prominent Acharya appeared and he firmly established the teachings of Vaishnavism, there were 12 other prominent devotees who appeared in this world before Ramanujacharya. So in their local language, they are called Alwars. Sometimes while writing, we'll write A-L. We call them Alwars. But actually, they are Alwars. And we'll discuss about two of these Alwars who are connected to each other. So for the discussion, we'll go to South India in a small village called Viliputtur. Today, it is called Sri Viliputtur. I checked about the location, it is roughly 80 kilometers southwest of Madurai. So probably it will take 2 hours, 1.5 to 2 hours to reach there today. So in this village lived a very nice devoted couple. Their names were Mukunda and Padma Devi. And this Mukunda and Padma Devi were very devoted to the Supreme Lord, Lord Vishnu. So in this village, there was a temple of Vishnu, and the form that was there in this temple was Vatapatra Shai. So just for the sake of those who don't know, what is this Vatapatra Shai? Vata, in Marathi they call it Vadacha Jhad. So banyan tree. Patra is a leaf and Shai means sleeping. So there is a specific form of the Lord as a baby sleeping on a banyan leaf. And how come, what is the story behind this form? So if you read the 12th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, it is mentioned how one of the great sages called Markandeya Rishi, somehow he had a desire to take darshan of the illusory potency of the Lord. Although most devotees, they offer obeisances to the material energy, illusory potency from a distance, and request her never to cast her loving glance on us. Yes. I know many devotees, you know, when you come to Radha Gopinath temple from the railway station, we come walking, so then there is a temple of Durga Devi. So I know many devotees who offer her obeisances from a distance and say, please keep us away from your glance. We don't want to be affected by you. But this devotee somehow, he had a desire, he prayed to Nar Narayan Rishi near Badrikashram. And he prayed that, I have one desire, I want to see what is your Maya Shakti. And the Lord is also so merciful. He didn't argue, he said, okay, so be it. And he went away. And then Markandeya Rishi is waiting for that energy to manifest in his life. And one day what happens is, as he is doing his tapasya, suddenly it starts raining. There is a thunderstorm, lightning, cold winds are blowing here and there. And in a matter of few seconds, it is mentioned, everything that he saw around was filled up with water. So during Govardhan Leela, it is mentioned, water similarly fell in huge quantities. So there it is mentioned, every drop of water was like a pillar. It was so thick. In this 12th canto, it is described, the water that was falling was like the wheels of a chariot. So the way I see it, it is more than that Govardhan Leela pastime. So it is mentioned, very soon Markandeya Rishi saw himself floating in that water, and he could not distinguish earth from sky. So almost the whole universe was filled up with water, 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 everywhere water. And slowly he saw there is nobody else surviving. He was the only one who surviving. The water is cold, it is still pouring, there is cold wind blowing, there is lightning, it is very fearful also. And in that whole huge deluge of water, he saw that there were many whirlpools also. So sometimes he would get sucked into those whirlpools and somehow escape those whirlpools. And then sometimes he saw that there were some deadly fish called a makara fish. Sometimes they are translated as sharks. But some people say, no, the makara fish is a special fish. Also, there were fish that can swallow whales in a single gulp. They are called timingila fish. So sometimes he would see these fishes also coming at him. And then another fish would come and they would fight with each other over who will eat Markandeya Rishi. And he's watching all this. So it is mentioned millions and millions of years passed in this way. He's all alone in water. And he's wondering, what is this happening? So usually what happens is we ask for something from the Supreme Lord and we forget it. But Krishna never forgets. And then he grants us that wish. And then when the reality dawns on us, actually this is not what I should have asked for. But then very few of us, because we are so much overwhelmed by that situation, very few of us can make that connection. Many years back I had asked for this, and probably this is the response to this. So maybe I should make another sincere appeal. I do not want. Yes? So many times when we go on yatras, this is a point that I always make, that because a holy place is a living place, yes, the tree is Kalpa Vriksha, the ground is Chintamani. And most of us have a habit of asking for something from the Supreme Lord. That is what we have been taught from our childhood. But very few of us have received training about what to ask from the Supreme Lord. And then we go to Vrindavan, we go to Mayapur, we go to some of these holy places, and we end up asking the same desires that we have been asking for in our own places, like maybe Bombay or some other places. And the problem with this whole thing is that in these holy places, the wishes can come true. So if you are not careful with your desires, you will be very sorry that you prayed for that desire. So similarly, Markandeya Rishi, he asked for something, and now after years and years of being tormented by all that situation, suddenly he sees in a distance there is an island, and on that island there is a tree, and it is a banyan tree. And then he is wondering, how come suddenly this tree survived? So he goes closer to that tree, and then he sees on the northeast direction of that tree, on one leaf there is a baby who's just smiling. And this baby is so bright, because everything is dark in the universe by this time. So it is mentioned the light, the effulgence of this baby is swallowing up all the darkness of the universe. Very effulgent baby. And Markandeya Rishi is attracted to the baby, and he slowly goes close to the baby and sees that baby. And the wonderful form of the baby is described. The baby's blue color is like that of a fresh emerald. There are three lines on the gentle throat of the baby, like a conch shell. There is also some folds of fat on his belly. And his arms are very beautiful. His legs are very beautiful. He has curly hair. And then as he's looking at Markandeya Rishi, he picks up his toe and slowly, smilingly puts it into his mouth. And Markandeya Rishi is looking at this beautiful sight. So who's this baby? This baby is baby Krishna, bluish colored. So Acharyas answer this question, why would the Supreme Lord want to suck his own toe? Sometimes babies do that in this world, but why would Krishna want to do it? So the Acharyas explain, the Supreme Lord thought, the whole world is trying to serve my lotus feet. Namo Pankaja Navaya, Namo Pankaja Angraya, Namo Pankaja Netraya, Namo Pankaja Maline. There are yogis who are meditating on my feet in their heart. And in general we say, oh my dear Krishna, please keep me at your lotus feet. Please keep me engaged in your service. So what is it that is there about my feet that devotees are so much attracted to? I want to taste the sweetness of my feet. So thinking like this, Krishna put his toe into his mouth. And this darshan was seen by Markandeya Rishi. And then that baby looked at Markandeya Rishi. And as he was about to ask this baby something, he sucked him. He breathed in. And Markandeya Rishi got sucked into the mouth of this baby. And when he went into the mouth of this baby, he came to the original situation before this whole thing happened. All those rains and all that happened. So he saw his own ashram near Badrika ashram. He saw the place where he had gotten darshan of Narayan Rishi. He saw the whole universe as it is. So then he's wondering, but it rained, and then I saw that baby, and then suddenly I am here. And then after some time, the baby breathed out. And Markandeya Rishi immediately found himself out. And then again he saw all that water and all that. And then in a moment, everything disappeared. The baby disappeared, the tree disappeared, the water disappeared, and Markandeya Rishi was again originally in his ashram. And then he understood all this whole thing was in reciprocation to his one small desire that he made from the Supreme Lord. So this form of that Supreme Lord is called Vatapatrashai. And in this Viliputtur village, this Vatapatrashai temple was there. So Mukunda and Padma Devi, they would worship this form of the Lord. They had a baby. This baby was so simple, this baby was so devoted to the Supreme Lord. They named him Vishnu Chitta. Like Parikshit Maharaj, he had so much attraction to the Supreme Lord right from his childhood days, he was called Vishnu Rat. So similarly here, this baby is called Vishnu Chitta. Jinke Chitta mein Bhagavan Vishnu hamesha base hain. So this Vishnu Chitta, he had so much attraction for the Supreme Lord, he decided, I want to dedicate my life for serving the Supreme Lord. But how will he serve the Supreme Lord? So he would listen to many stories about the Supreme Lord. One day in some program like this, he heard how he was listening to Vishnu Puran. So in this Vishnu Puran, it is mentioned one time Krishna and Balram, when they came to Mathura, when Akrura brought them to Mathura to have a wrestling match with Kamsa, Krishna and Balram went to a small shop in a small alley. Alley matlab Hindi mein usko bolte hai gali. To choti si gali mein ek dukaan mein gaye Krishna aur Balram. Wo kiski dukaan thi? To Vishnu Puran mentions it was the shop of a malakar. Malakar means garland maker, har banane wala. If you read the 41st chapter of the 10th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, this story is described in great detail. How Krishna and Balram have reached Mathura and they see one washerman. And they ask the washerman, oh, you are carrying such nice clothes. Why don't you give us some of these clothes? And what does the washerman do? The washerman is actually the official washerman, the dhobi of Kamsa, the king. And he actually insults Krishna and Balram by calling them, you are just forest dwellers. You are mountain dwellers. Girivanachare. So he is pointing to Vrindavan as something inferior. He is thinking, Mathura is a city. Aap log kya, Marathi mein sometimes they say, in Bombay they say, Gauti, Gauwale, something like that. So he calls Krishna and Balram Gauwale and he says, you don't deserve these clothes. So if somebody asks you for something and you don't want to give it, there is a particular way of speaking, is it not? We can always disagree with somebody without being disrespectful. But somehow this art is conspicuous in today's world. If we agree with somebody, then we'll flatter him. If we disagree with somebody, we'll humiliate him down to the core. So this person, he could have just told Krishna and Balaram, no, these clothes belong to somebody else, and I won't share these clothes with you. But what did he say? He pointed them out. He pointed out that you are from a village, and you are uncivilized people. I won't give these clothes to you. Then he said that, do you know what will happen to you if you do this? He says, these clothes belong to the king. I will immediately call the guards and have you killed here right now. So he threatens them. So now first he's insulted Krishna and Balaram unnecessarily. And then he's threatening to kill them. So Krishna becomes angry and Krishna takes his fingertip and touches to his neck. And without using any weapons, without displaying his Sudarshan Chakra, any sword, any knife or something like that, the head just falls off. Lord Balaram also, when he met Romaharshan, and Romaharshan failed to offer him obeisances, then Lord Balaram also goes close to him, takes his fingertip and touches to his neck, and Romaharshan's head just falls down. Angani asya sakalendriya vrittimante. Krishna's senses, any of the senses can perform the job of any other sense. He does not have to do something very special. So this Rajaka, this washerman, his head falls down right in front of everyone. So there are all his chamchas, cronies. They run away here and there, afraid. Krishna and Balaram take those clothes, decorate themselves. And as he's decorating themselves, as they're decorating themselves, they see a weaver. There is some person who's in charge of clothes. So he says, oh, Krishna and Balaram, they have dressed themselves with clothes. Can I decorate them in some way? So he comes with some armlets, some ornaments made up of cloth. He's not a rich person. He does not have gold and silver and like that. But sometimes, you know, even for Gopinath, they have these armlets that are actually made up of some cloth, but they shine like they are made up of gold. And he on his own comes and decorates Krishna. So there is a contrast between this Rajaka and this weaver. This Rajaka also serves Kamsa. This weaver also serves Kamsa. And the Rajaka tried to use his position to threaten Krishna and Balaram. And this weaver, even though he is also a servant of Kamsa, but he does not use his position to threaten Krishna and Balaram. He uses his facilities to serve Krishna and Balaram. But what does it take to serve Krishna and Balaram in a city like Mathura? In a city like Mathura, the king has been publicly warned in front of everyone. The eighth child of Devaki is going to be the cause of your death. And Kamsa, every single day, has sent at least three demons to kill Krishna. The whole city knows this. Everyone knows this. Kamsa and Krishna, they are sworn enemies. At least Kamsa thinks like that. Maybe not Krishna thinks like that. So in Kamsa's capital, where there are 100 CCTV cameras around, where everyone is watching, to serve Krishna is not just an act of service. Actually, it's an act of courage. It's an act of bravery. Yes, definitely it shows the softness of one's heart, but it also shows how this person was determined and was ready to pay any price to please the Supreme Lord. So generally, for most of us today, you know, we have this habit of saying, Are Kaliyug mein toh zamana bahut kharab hai. Kaliyuga is a very bad time to serve the Supreme Lord. But actually, if you read those times when Kamsa was ruling Mathura, read the Srimad Bhagavatam. What kind of atrocities he was performing on his people. Today, the political leaders of this country do not perform those kind of atrocities on the citizens of India. Nowhere is there a board which stops you from worshipping Krishna. Nowhere is there a law in the constitution of India that stops you from chanting Hare Krishna. So if you read those times, you'll be surprised to see the atmosphere that permeated in Dwapar Yug, when all these kings like Jarasandha, Shishupal, Kamsa himself, when they were ruling, actually to worship God was not very easy. I could compare this in a very simple way to some Vaishnavas trying to worship the Supreme Lord in the Middle East part of this world, where officially it is banned to do deity worship. You cannot do Murti Puja there. In certain countries in the Middle East, if you are carrying the beads in your suitcase, if they catch you with some beads, then they'll throw those beads away. If you have photographs of the Supreme Lord, then they'll tear those photographs. So in India, there are no such laws. In India, the atmosphere is very much favorable, but still, I'm not pointing at somebody. This is about me also. But somehow, you know, we are very expert in finding out reasons why we should not be practicing spiritual life sincerely. So, क्या करें, अभी समय बहुत खराब है. कहां खराब है समय? समय तो बहुत अच्छा है. Nobody can snatch away your beadbag from you. I have seen devotees chanting in local trains also. So, is there somebody who can snatch away beadbag? Is there somebody who is moving around with a gun, just looking at somebody? Is there anybody worshipping Lord Vishnu? But if you read Srimad Bhagavatam, this is what was happening in Mathura at that time. You could not worship Krishna. You could not worship the Supreme Lord. All the citizens were supposed to serve and only serve the king. You read Jarasandh. Jarasandh had captured more than 100 or 1000 kings from different parts of the provinces near Magadha to slaughter them. So they are kings in their own right. And they have been captured by Jarasandh just by his power, and he wants to offer their heads, Narbali, to Kal Bhairav. And then Krishna, later, he liberates all those kings. So think about it. All of us who are complaining about bad times today, actually times are very good. We have freedom. We can do what we want to do. But it is just our own laziness. It's our own procrastination. We always want to delay. One time His Holiness Radhanath Maharaj was saying, Maya cheats non-devotees by convincing them not to surrender to Krishna. And the same Maya cheats devotees by convincing them to delay their surrender to Krishna. So we have to be very careful of Maya's tricks. So coming back to our own original point, this Rajaka, he used Kamsa's, his connection with Kamsa to threaten Krishna and Balaram. And this weaver, he is using the ornaments that he has to decorate Krishna and Balaram. And Krishna and Balaram become very happy with this weaver. And they grant him long life, prosperity, and they move on. So then they go to the florist, the Malakar's home. So it is described, this Malakar is just sitting outside his home and he's waiting for somebody to come. And as soon as Krishna and Balaram come, he falls flat on the ground, offers his obeisances and says, oh, I am so happy. I am sure my forefathers, the demigods and the sages are happy on me by the fact that Krishna and Balaram have come to my home. How can I serve you? How can I serve you? And Krishna and Balaram are so kind. Krishna and Balaram don't expect anything from him. They just say, okay, whatever you want to do, you can do. And Malakar is looking around, what to do. And the Malakar, all he has is garlands. He has a variety of garlands. So he picks the best two garlands. Srila Jiva Goswami points out, even those two garlands were picked up in such a way that out of those two also there was one which was the best. It's not that those two were equal. So he picked the best two, and out of those two there was one which was really the topmost. And he gave the best garland to Krishna, and he gave the second best garland to Balaram, and he chose garlands made up of fresh, this is specifically mentioned by Shukadeva Goswami, those garlands were made up of fresh flowers, and they were very fragrant flowers, and they were very attractive flowers. So he just didn't pick up any garland and give it to Krishna and Balaram. It was the fruit of all his sadhana. He was seeing this interaction with Krishna and Balaram as a reciprocation to his desire, like Markandeya Rishi got reciprocation to his desire, something like that. So now, what does it take to offer a garland to the Supreme Lord? In our temple in the morning class, when the Bhagavatam class is going on, in this neighboring room, there are some Matajis. For years and years, we have seen them, they take flowers and they make a garland every day for Gopinath. And the next day, Gopinath wears that garland. For years and years, they're making those garlands. And sometimes after the Bhagavatam class, they also sing some songs also. They sing some bhajans. So all they are doing is, they take some flowers, they take a needle, there's a thread, and they put all those flowers and make some kind of a good combination. So there are some white flowers, there are some rose petals, and like that. Looks very attractive. And where did those flowers come from? Those flowers came from trees that have been given by the Supreme Lord. So in one sense, from an ordinary vision, if you see, it's a very simple thing to do. pluck flowers, take a thread, take a needle, arrange them in an attractive fashion, offer them to the Supreme Lord. But what happened is, just like Krishna, when he received those cloth ornaments, Krishna became very happy and he gave unlimited prosperity to the viewer. Krishna became very happy with this Malakar. Again, why did he become happy with this Malakar? Because Malakar was also taking a big risk to glorify Krishna in Mathura. So although we may look at the story from a very external perspective, Krishna never ever has an external perspective on any event. Krishna goes to the root of everything. So Krishna is looking, what is the price that this florist, Malakar, is paying to offer me a garland? He's offering me his energy. He's offering me his intelligence by choosing which flowers to put where so that it becomes very attractive. But most of all, he could risk his life to offer me this garland. The soldiers of Kamsa could come and just kill him, rip him off, just for offering me this garland. So Krishna is noting all those subtle things also that most of us can miss. And Krishna and Balaram become so happy on this Malakar. They say, what do you want? I want to give you something in return. So now what would this Malakar ask? It is mentioned this garland maker asks three benedictions from Krishna and Balaram. He says, please grant me unwavering affection to you. Zindagi mein kuch bhi ho jaye, lekin meri aapke prati jo aastha hai, wo kabhi dagmagaye na. Let me always remain fixed up in my bhakti for you. First benediction. Second, he says, give me maitri, give me loving friendship with your devotees. And third thing he says, give me transcendental compassion for the people in general. So if you remember, these three things are also asked by Parikshit Maharaj in the first canto. He is also praying to the sage in front of him, all the sadhus that are sitting in front of him. He's saying, O Lord, O Supreme Lord, please give me loving affection for you. Please give me loving dealings with your devotees. And please also give me daya bhav, kripa, for people in general, so that I may preach to them, I may attract them, I may convince them that they will also become devotees of yours. So it is said in that shloka where Parikshit Maharaj is praying for these three things, the first line of the purport, Prabhupada writes, this is the definition of a perfect devotee. So Prabhupada is teaching us, what should an ideal devotee pray for? Aisa hum log sam kam ke poochte hai na. I have seen devotees asking, Prabhu, I am going to a holy place. I am going to a special temple. What should I pray for? So out of a myriad of desires that we have, sometimes we understand some of those desires are not very worthy desires. So what exact desire should I pray for? Sometimes it is somebody's appearance day, birthday. And then we are in the habit of praying to the Supreme Lord. Then you say, what should I pray for? Should I pray for wealth? Should I pray for health? Should I pray for greater attraction for the holy names? Should I pray for greater attraction to reading the Srimad Bhagavatam? What should I pray for? Should I pray for greater strength for preaching? But Prabhupada in that purport, he begins the purport by saying, this is the definition of a perfect devotee. He asks for three things always. So in today's terms, we can call this horizontal and vertical relationships. There's a x-axis and y-axis. So vertical relationships are relationships with our seniors. Maybe with our Gurujan, Shiksha Guru, Diksha Guru. Above our Shiksha Guru, Diksha Guru are the Acharyas, Srila Prabhupada, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati and so on. And then above them is Lord Chaitanya, the Panchatattva. And then there is Radha Krishna and their associates. So usually, in the beginning, most of us will be attracted only to our vertical relationships. We just want a relationship with the spiritual master. We want a relationship with the Acharyas. We have heard stories of how they are very merciful. And definitely all of us want a relationship with the Supreme Lord. But very few people understand, to have a vertical relationship with the Supreme Lord, there has to be a good foundation of a horizontal relationship with my equals, with my peers, with devotees who are contemporary right now. Just for an example's sake, think if you want to create a structure to stay in, you want to construct a house. So obviously a house is made up of walls, and the walls go vertically up. But in order for you to build very good, strong walls that will protect you vertically, that will protect you from all dangers, actually there has to be a strong foundation on a horizontal level. So if at all you have seen a construction site, in Bombay you can come across many construction sites. First, you know, that land is purchased and then there is a fence put up around. And then it is said, this site belongs to such and such developers or such and such builders, like that. And then you will be surprised that when they want to construct a building vertically up, actually they start by digging vertically down. Why would they do it? You thought a skyscraper was something that scrapes the sky. So skyscraper is something that rises tall in the sky. But the skyscraper, in order for it to stand straight and tall, actually a very strong foundation is required. Taller the skyscraper, deeper has to be the foundation. So they first dig into the ground and then they create a very strong foundation. And usually the width and the breadth of the building is a little less than the foundation. The foundation is always more broader than the size and the shape, the borders of the building. Why? Because the horizontal foundation has to be always there to support the vertical building. Similarly, I was asking this question to some devotees. From the beginning of our lives in Krishna consciousness, from the day from which we started coming to the temple, I still remember when I started coming to the temple, there was a group of devotees, and every Sunday feast, before the Sunday feast class, we would assemble around 12:30, and we would dance together in kirtan. And then we would attend the class, and after the class, we would again dance together in kirtan. So there was a group of 4 or 5 young boys. That time I was young. Long time back. And we would dance together. And there was a group. So we would eagerly look forward to coming together and dancing together and listening together and again dancing together and having prasad together. That was every Sunday. And then over a period of time, I remember out of those 5, I can remember 2 who are still devotees. 2 of them have vanished. So I was asking this question to a group of devotees. What is the difference between somebody who came to the temple and stayed and somebody who came to the temple and did not stay? What makes the difference? Because if we do not know this difference, probably we also have come to the temple, but we won't stay. And if we know the difference and if we can learn what is the difference, then by taking care of it, we will not only come to the temple, we will keep coming to the temple and we'll keep staying in the temple, and most probably we'll also attract others to come and stay in the temple. So what is it? So many things came out in the discussion. Some people said maybe it is aparad. Some people said maybe it is vishaya sakti, attraction to material pleasure. So yes, you know, there were many reasons that came out. At the end of the discussion, what came out is actually those who caught hold of at least one hand in the temple. So when you come to the temple, I have seen many devotees, when they enter through the main door, they want to take a right turn. Yes, we want to be right in our lives, so we take a right turn. But actually, the right turn when you enter the temple hall is not the right turn, it is the left turn. You take the left turn and, you know, you offer half obeisances to all the devotees in this temple hall, then you offer full obeisances to Srila Prabhupada, and then you will see those who are long standing devotees, they do all this. And those who are new, somehow over a period of time this culture has deteriorated in our temple, but so many people, they just come and straight come to Krishna. But if you are a little alert and you look around, then you will see the senior devotees, they will come, they'll first offer half obeisances, vancha kalpatarubhyash. Then they get up and they offer full obeisances to Srila Prabhupada. And then they turn and then they offer full obeisances to the Supreme Lord. So these are devotees who are willing to form horizontal relationships with the devotees right now. And then they offer their obeisances in their vertical relationships to the acharyas and then obviously to the Supreme Lord. So what is the difference between people who came and people who stayed? Think about somebody who came to the temple but who did not stay. Think about him. Think about her. And deep within you will find out those devotees mostly fail to strike a relationship, strike a friendship with some contemporary devotee. They got swayed in the effect of time. Time is very strong. Time is very powerful. Big empires have collapsed. So in that discussion it came out, you know, we can say, you know, a river, have you ever seen a river that is flowing with strong current? Nothing stands in its way. You put something in that river, it will get flown. Yes. So similarly it is said many times in the Bhagavatam, you'll say pravaha. So guna pravaha, or sometimes it is called kal ke pravaha se sab kuch beh jata hai. Kal ke pravaha mein sab kuch nasht ho jata hai. So then I was comparing that all of us are in the river of time, and this river of time is constantly flowing. Narad Muni, when he is talking to the Hariyashvas, he uses this analogy. He says, there is a river which flows mildly in the center, and there is a river, it flows mildly in the center and it flows swiftly towards the ends. Do you know any river like that? So then it is mentioned, this river is the river of time. How time is flowing. And the more you try to escape time, the more it flows very swiftly. So imagine you are in a river and which is flowing very swiftly. And you want to stay at one place. What will you do? So you are looking around for some support, something to catch on to. What do you want? You want anything and everything that you can latch on to that will protect you. So I was saying, will you get a strong, huge tree just next to the river banks? Most probably not. Mostly those big, huge trees are somewhere inside. On the banks of the river is usually some creepers or some small shrubs and like that, yes? So imagine you are being swept in a river and you are crying out, "Arre, bachao, 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 main to behte ja raha hu." And you catch one of something. And you know what that is? That is a small twig, that is a small branch, or that is a small gentle creeper. But that creeper is not an independent creeper. Creepers are usually woven around some strong tree. Okay? So you caught hold of that creeper, it's not a strong tree, but that creeper has a good connection with some tree. Yes? Will that creeper save you from being flown in that river? Yes. So many of us want a tree to be saved from. But the problem with trees is the trees grow somewhere deep inside. Actually, for a person who's flowing in a river, even a small creeper, even a small twig, even something very simple can save him, provided that simple creeper or that simple tree is connected to a big tree deep inside. So mostly all of us want to have a direct connection with Guru Maharaj. Most of us, we want to have a direct connection with Srila Prabhupada. Most of us, we want to have a direct connection with the Supreme Lord. And mostly we won't use the word direct connection. We replace the word direct with a personal connection. It sounds better. I want to have a personal connection. So those of us who are fortunate, we are fortunate. But most of us are not fortunate to have a personal connection, a direct connection. Just, you know, if we accept the reality and say, I do not have a direct connection, but can I have a connection with somebody who has a direct connection? So I am comparing the Acharyas, the Supreme Lord, to a big, huge, bulky tree and a creeper that is wound around that tree to the contemporary devotees who are not so strong, but they are strong enough to save us. So those who stayed and those who did not stay, if I can think back, the difference, yes, to some extent it could be aparas and this and that, but primarily I can say, all those devotees, they always took a right turn when they entered the temple hall. And those who stayed, they always took a left turn after entering the temple hall. So, this is the prayer that is offered by this Malakar. He wants these three things from the Supreme Lord, and the Supreme Lord is happy on him. So this Vishnu Chitta, when he is growing up, one day he hears this story. And he says, this Malakar, just by offering one flower garland to Krishna, he pleased Krishna. So why am I so much interested in doing so many other things to please Krishna? So that day, this Vishnu Chitta, he decided, I will not go to a Gurukul. He's born in a Brahmin family. That was expected. That was his parents' expectations. He decided, I'm not going to a Gurukul. I'm not going to study. The goal of my life is to offer beautiful garlands to Vatapatra Shai. And every day he would make the best garlands to offer to the Supreme Lord in that temple. And this is how he grew up. So, you know, today we have a darshan. It is mentioned, Toyam Priya Gopal. That is what is mentioned here. So the devotees who were engaged in making this darshan, they told me, Prabhu, please speak something about Toyam Priya Gopal. So as my humble duty towards them, I wanted to speak a few things about this. Krishna in 9.26, he speaks this, Patram, Pushpam, Phalam, Toyam. Four things. He says, please offer me with love. And anybody offers these four things to me with love, I will accept it. So last Sunday was a Phalam Priya Gopal. Last Sunday they decorated Gopal with a lot of mango fruits. So one senior devotee in our temple, I had mentioned this in one Bhagavatam class, but because this devotee has requested me, I would like to mention it again. One senior devotee was explaining, what does it mean, this Patram, Pushpam, Phalam, Toyam? So Patram ordinarily refers to one leaf, and that is the translation usually. If one offers to me with love a leaf, a flower, a fruit and some water, I will accept it. So this senior devotee was explaining, what does it mention? Roop Patram matlab kya hai? So he was saying, in earlier days, the scriptures would not be written and printed on pages. They would be written on palm leaves. So the leaves will be taken from a tree, then they will be dried, and with a sharp kind of an instrument, things will be engraved, the letters will be engraved. And then you take some ink, and then you smear it. And then wherever there is engraving, the ink will go inside. The powder ink will go inside. That is how you store scriptures. So this devotee was explaining, actually what Krishna is saying is, will you offer me a leaf every day? Means, will you offer me one leaf of the scriptures every day? Will you read one page of the scriptures every day? So somebody says, I don't have so much intelligence. I don't have so much time to read the Bhagavad Gita every day. One page bhi nahi padhunga main. Then Krishna says, okay, no problem, Baba. At least offer me one tulsi leaf. Then comes Pushpam. So what is Pushpam? So this devotee was mentioning, ordinarily it refers to one flower. Krishna is saying, can you offer me one flower available for free? Then somebody says, actually I don't have so much time to go to a tree, pluck a flower, then offer it to you. There are many other important things to do. Krishna says, okay, my expectation actually was, you know, we can compare all of us to a bird. Bird matlab kali. So kali kaise hai, dheere 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 aise phool mein parivartit ho jati hai. So similarly right now all of us are like a bird. We are untrained devotees. But yes, we have a desire to serve Krishna, we have a desire to please Krishna. So as we grow in devotional service, we can compare ourselves to a bud that slowly opens up, to a bud that slowly flowers. So slowly as we become mature in devotional service, slowly we'll open up. We'll become more and more beautiful. We'll become more and more fragrant. We'll become more and more attractive. We'll become fit enough to be offered to the Supreme Lord. So Krishna, when he says, Pushpam, mujhe arpan kijiye, what Krishna is saying is, my dear devotee, please make some effort to become, to advance, to become mature every day. Every day try to do something that will make you a better devotee. Take one small step in the right direction. Learn from devotees around you what pleases Krishna, what does not please Krishna. Take some small resolution every day. Dheere 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 apne kali ko ek phool mein parivartit karne ka prayas kijiye. To mujhe wo pushpa arpan kijiye aap. Then somebody says, I don't have so much time to advance every day, to become a better devotee. I am what I am. Mujhe jaisa hu waisa swikar kijiye. Then Krishna, okay, offer me a flower at least. Phalam. So Krishna is saying, whatever you do, whatever efforts you do, there is some fruit, kuch phal milta hai uska. We are always working hard, expecting something in return. So Krishna is saying, please offer to me that fruit of your efforts. Karma ke phal mujhe arpan kijiye. Then we say, no, I am very attached to my karma phal. Main kya aapke liye karma kar raha hu kya? Main to mere liye kar raha hu. Krishna says, okay, no problem, at least offer me a physical phal. And then Krishna is saying, toyam. Toyam means water. So none of us will actually like salty water. We stay near this ocean and there's so much water here. But when we offer water to Krishna, then we offer sweet water. But Krishna, when he says, offer me water, this devotee was explaining, actually Krishna is saying, please offer to me sincere tears. Every day, come to me and offer sincere tears of repentance. My dear Krishna, so many years and so many lifetimes I spent away from you. That was a mistake. Now I have realized what is the right thing to do in life. Please accept me. Offer sincere prayers to Krishna. Krishna, meri aadat hai bahut buri hai, meri ichha hai bahut buri hai, lekin my direction is right. Please help me walk in the right direction, although I am walking, faltering at every step. Please help me. And they can be accompanied by tears. This salty water. But this salty water is very pleasing to Krishna. And if you cannot offer this salty water, then at least offer some sweet water, some tap water. That, now interesting thing is, these four things which Krishna wants from us, none of them have been produced by us. A leaf is natural, a flower is natural, fruit is natural, and water is natural. So just see the magnanimity of the Supreme Lord. All that he asks from you is all that has been provided by him. So today they have shown how we can offer simple water to Krishna. And by offering the simple water to Krishna, we can please Krishna. So this Vishnu Chitta, when he heard the story of Malakar, he decided, I am going to offer a flower garland to the Supreme Lord every day. And then he started cultivating a garden close to this Vatapatrashai. He purchased some land close to the temple, and the goal of his life became getting newer and newer plants of very fresh flowers, fragrant flowers, and offering those garlands to the Supreme Lord. So the king of that province, his name was Vallabh Dev. One day this Vallabh Dev, as a very responsible king, was moving around in the kingdom, and on the doorstep of one temple he found one Brahmin looking very effulgent, and he was just lying down. So this king thought, I should go and ask this Brahmin, what is the goal of life? Just like we hear in the Srimad Bhagavatam, how Lord Krishna, as a responsible king, would move around in Dwarka with a disguise and ask people, kya aapko, main puchna chahta hu, Dwarkadish ke bare mein aapka kya kehna hai? Is Krishna a good king? Who's asking? Krishna is asking. Lord Ramchandra also in the Ramayana is described how he would move around in a disguise and ask, what do you think about the character of Lord Ramchandra? Who is asking? Lord Ramchandra is asking. So responsible kings or responsible leaders are always interested in feedback. Today we see how leaders, when they assume the leadership position, they think, I have earned my right to become a leader and my subordinates better obey me, better do what I tell them to do. But long, many, many centuries back, Lord Ramchandra has shown, although he is Maryada Purushottam, he is the ideal in every respect, still, he will go and ask people, aapka kya kehna hai, Ramchandra ji kaise hai, achhe raja hai ki bure raja hai? So what to speak of those leaders in today's times who are full of faults? We are made leaders not by our qualification, we are made leaders because there is nobody else around. Abhi koi nahi hai to chalo, aap hi ban jao leader. So how much we should be interested in taking feedback from our subordinates, that I think I am right, but am I really right? In my decisions, am I actually benefiting you or am I harming you in the name of benefiting you? So this king also, Vallabh Dev, he was a responsible king and he wanted to ask this Brahmin. So he woke up this Brahmin and said, my dear Brahmin, please tell me something that will improve my life. So he said, actually I don't know much, but some time back I had been on a pilgrimage to Kashi. And there I met some sadhus. And I also asked this question to the sadhus, how to improve one's life, and they gave me some answer which I would like to pass on to you. So it's very interesting how this sadhu was a very honest sadhu. He is saying, sahi main bolu kya, mujhe kuch malum nahi hai, lekin maine jo suna hai wo main aapko batata hu. So Vallabh Dev is asking, and the sadhu said, those sadhus told me, see, a man works 8 months very hard so that he can rest for 4 months. So this is around 500-600 years back, when the rainy season, you could not do much. So 8 months you would work hard to enjoy. Then he says, see, just like a person works hard during the day so that he can rest peacefully at night time. Similarly, the human form of life is supposed to be invested in working hard for spiritual realization so that you can rest and have fun with the Supreme Lord in the spiritual world. Pehle mehnat karenge to aage ki zindagi achhi rahegi. So this is not our original life. This is a temporary means to the goal. So as soon as this King Vallabhdev heard this from the Brahmin, this King Vallabhdev, something happened, epiphany. He said, I have to do this. I have to become serious about spiritual realization. Because we feel to impress upon somebody, we have to come up with something very fantastic. But actually in many stories in the scriptures, it is mentioned how a very sincere person asked a simple question to a realized person. And that realized person, because he was practicing something himself, when he spoke something very simple, actually it makes an impact on the heart of the listener. Impact on the heart is never made if you are speaking from your intelligence. If I am speaking from my intelligence, it affects your intelligence. If I am speaking from my heart, it affects your heart. So is this a big analogy? Is this a very complicated analogy? Simple. You work in the day so that you can rest at night. You work 8 months of the year so that you can rest 4 months of the year. Similarly, you work hard in the human form of life. Don't waste this human form of life so that after this human form of life, when you go to the Supreme Lord, then you can have your real pleasurable life. But it penetrated the heart of this King Vallabhdev. So he goes to his minister and he says, I want to know how to get guidance so that I can improve my human form of life, because now I'm more focused on the life after. I'm more focused on the life in the spiritual world. So he says, simple, you need a guru, you need a spiritual master. So he says, okay, tell me how to get a spiritual master. So he says, see, there are many saintly people in this kingdom and they could guide an ordinary person. But since you are a king, it takes a lot of expertise to guide a king. One of the biggest sections in the Mahabharata is the Bhishma Parva. It's not the Vana Parva. And what is Bhishma Parva? Bhishma Parva is, Bhishma is lying on a bed of arrows and he is asked questions by Yudhishthir, how to rule the world now that after the Mahabharata war, I am supposed to rule the world. And Bhishma on a bed of arrows is just telling him instructions. Ek raja ne kaise raj karna chahiye. That is, it is said, it is roughly 60 to 70% of the Mahabharata. So we thought Mahabharata is all about the story of the Pandavas, but actually a major chunk is instructions of Bhishma, how to rule in a proper way. Think about it. It means how important is guidance for a king. And it also means how important is guidance for all of us. How much we should have our lives guided by somebody who knows what is what and what is not. So all of us, you know, we should take this very seriously, that this king is interested in spiritual realization. And then he says, okay, now tell me how to get this guru. So he says, we need the best person to guide you. So announce a debate. And when all these jnani people, all these knowledgeable people will come, we will select somebody who has the highest realizations and then he will guide you for spiritual life. So this king announces a debate and then many, many jnani people come. So one of the ways in which the winner of this debate will be honored is, obviously he has to be a man of intelligence, but then there is a flagpole, it's like khamba hai, in the assembly of the king, and the king takes some very special wealth, some gems, some diamonds, some gold, something like that, and then he binds it into a cloth, and that cloth is hoisted by a rope on top of that pole. And it is mentioned, if somebody is meant to be the guide of the king, automatically that treasure will come down. There is some arrangement like that. So many people in that kingdom who want to be advisors to the king, they come there and they start arguing. Meanwhile, the Supreme Lord, he comes in the dreams of this Vishnu Chitta, who is an illiterate person, who has never gone to Gurukul. All his life he has just made garlands for the Supreme Lord. And he tells him, King Vallabhdev has organized a debate. It is my desire that you go and participate in that debate. So in the dream, he argues with the Supreme Lord. He said, what do you think I'll do? Do you want me to get insulted right in front of everyone? I can't speak anything. I am just a simple malakar. The Supreme Lord says, you don't worry about it. You go. I want you to go. So what can he do? He has to go there. So when he enters the debate arena, some scholars, they get up and they say, this is an insult to us. Just the fact that you are allowing an illiterate person to even come close to us, this is an insult to us. We won't want to participate. But the king, you know, he feels he's a devotee and the king is also interested in spiritual realization. So the king indicates to the scholars, if you want to participate, keep quiet. So they say, okay, Raja ke samne kiski chalegi? To baith jate hai shanti se. And then after all the debate happens, not much conclusion. Then he tells this Vishnu Chitta, you also speak something. So what will this Vishnu Chitta speak? In 10.33 of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Aksharanam Akarosmi. Krishna says, of all the alphabets, I am the alphabet A. A. So why is it mentioned like this? Because from the sound A, after the sound A, come all the alphabets. Right? A, A, E, E, and so on. So what is the most important alphabet? A, because that is from where it starts. So Vishnu Chitta, when he gets a chance to speak, he says, actually, I don't know anything. But all I know is the Supreme Lord is the sound A, the sound A. That is the beginning of everything. Similarly, Lord Vishnu is the beginning of everything. So, such a simple analogy. And Narad Muni has also spoken how this whole world is like a tree. But the tree grows from the roots. So he compares Lord Vishnu to the roots of a tree. Although we see the whole huge tree, we never see the roots. But Narad Muni says, similarly, we see this world, but we don't see the source of this world, Supreme Lord Vishnu. Simple analogies. But the question is, who is speaking it? A person who's practicing what he's speaking, a person who's living by that, he is Vishnu Chitta. His whole life he has dedicated to service of Lord Vishnu. So when he speaks, there is a lot of conviction in that. And he gives a simple analogy and he speaks a few more examples. And it is mentioned, all those big scholars in that assembly, their hearts melt. They think, humko to itne sare bade ved aate hain, lekin wo ved ka purpose, what is the purpose of those Vedas, we never knew. Vedaischa sarvair aham eva vedyo. By all the Vedas, I am to be known, Krishna says. तो पूरा ऐसा बोलते हैं ना मतलब जैसे मथुरा के पेड़े बहुत फेमस है सो इफ यू गो टू मथुरा एंड देन यू कम बैक सम ऑफ योर फ्रेंड्स इन ऑफिस विल आस्क यू तो मथुरा गए हाँ गए मथुरा के पेड़े लाए कि नहीं नहीं लाए तो फिर क्या किया फिर मथुरा में और सम टाइम समबडी गोस आई नो सम डिवोटीज दे वेंट टू मथुरा ऑन सम यात्रा एंड देन व्हेन दे वेंट टू देयर ऑफिस पीपल सेड ओ यू वेंट टू मथुरा यस डिड यू गो टू आगरा सो वी नेवर वेंट टू आगरा वी वेंट टू मथुरा अरे उधर से पास में ही है ना So they feel the goal of life, you know, if you go to Mathura, Agra, that area, the goal is actually to see the Taj Mahal. For them, Mathura, Vrindavan, Govardhan, Yamuna, very ordinary things. So sometimes they will say like, Agra ke, haan ke, pethe laya ki nahi Agra ke? So similarly, you know, these scholars, they are thinking, we read all the Vedas, but we did not understand how Vishnu is the object of all the Vedas, and this Vishnu Chitta knows. So some of the scholars started crying. And right in front of everyone, as this Vishnu Chitta started speaking the glorification of the Supreme Lord Vishnu, that treasure that was hoisted on a pole, it automatically started lowering down. So now it was proved in front of everyone. Actually, Lord Vishnu also wants that this person should be honored as the best scholar and he should be given the title as the spiritual master of the king. Everyone accepts it. In Vrindavan, there is one temple called Lala Babu Temple. Many times when we go on a yatra, we never visit this temple. But it is very famous in that area. So you know what is the story of the temple? Actually, it is a temple of Radha Krishna. But it was built by one landlord. Ek zamindar the. He was staying in Calcutta. So one day, Vaishnav, nice person. So one day, towards the last part of his life, he's having a walk on the Hooghly River, Ganga River, on the banks of the river. And he's thinking, I spent my whole life doing business and now I'm a rich person. But somehow I never got satisfaction in my life. So what to do now to get satisfaction? And as he's walking, there are two washerwomen, dhobi ki patniya, dhoban. They are washing clothes and they are talking with each other. So in Bengali language they say, Are iski vasna to jaldi chali gai. So vasa, you know, in typical language it means clothes. So vasna in Bengali language also means the color of the clothes. So it seems their husbands had dyed clothes and then they are saying, the clothes are losing their colors fast, not very good. But as they are talking with each other, Lala Babu hears, Are iski vasna to jaldi chali gai. He thinks about himself. Vasna also means material desires. Desires to enjoy in this material world. So he says, Oh my God, these women are talking. Iski vasna jaldi chali gai. Lekin meri vasna jaldi nahi gai. So he starts thinking. Then as he goes ahead, there is a boatman. And this boatman is talking to himself. Oh, jaldi baitho, humko to nadi paar karke us paar jana hai. He's talking like that. So Lala Babu thinks, My God, actually I am also supposed to cross the river. Between the material world and the spiritual world, there is a river called Viraja River. So many times it is said, in order to go to the spiritual world, we have to cross this river. So he is talking about the river Ganga, the boatman, but Lala Babu hears that and he is reminded of this Viraja River. So he's like, oh, see this boatman is so eager to cross the river, but I am not so eager to cross the river. And he's thinking, oh, I should not do this. So it is mentioned this Lala Babu, that day evening he went to his home, packed his clothes, and left for Vrindavan. So when he went to Vrindavan, he also wanted to take shelter of a guru. So he approached the most famous saintly person in Vrindavan, fell at his feet, and he said, please give me some guidance. So he said, no, there is still time for you. So what did Lala Babu do? Lala Babu, because now he has given up all his wealth, now he has given up all his prestige. In Vrindavan, he is just an ordinary bhikari. He is just an ordinary businessman. He is just an ordinary beggar. And he would do bhiksha at different homes. And regularly he would come to this saintly person and he would ask, please guide me. You know, I left all my riches, I left all my business. I'm very serious. Just look at me. I'm not faking it. But still this guru, he never accepted him as his disciple. So one day, you know, he was just thinking, why is it this guru is not accepting me? Maybe I'm falling short of something. So then he thought, actually when he was a rich businessman, he had a rival. In any business there is a rival. So there was one rival who was a very rich businessman and he was from Mathura. This rival was from Mathura. So when he would go for bhiksha, bhiksha matlab kahin bhi jana chahiye, hai ki nahi? To bhiksha ke samay, he would go to every single home in Mathura and Vrindavan, but he would always avoid the home of that rival. It's very painful for a person to go to his rival's home and ask for bhiksha. So the guru would always ask from somebody, did this person go to that person's home for bhiksha? And the answer would be no, that's why the guru was not accepting. So he thought, whatever could be done, I have already done. I think my Guru Maharaj wants me now to not just do tyaga of my wealth, to not just do tyaga of my prestige, but also do tyag of my ahankar. Ye bhi aakhri ahuti mujhe yagya kund mein dalni padegi. And that day he went with a begging bowl to his rival. And this rival had not yet become a sadhu. This rival was a nice rich man. And he's knocking on the door and that rich man comes. And here is his rival. He's saying, Bhiksham Dehi. And the rival, he understood, this is humility. When you go with somebody whom you have fought, with somebody whom you always showed how intelligent you are, to beg in front of that person is really very difficult. And he gave him some bhiksha. And that day the guru sent for this Lala Babu. He said, you come to me, I want to give you diksha. So this is the story of the Lala Babu. How, you know, he was very humble and he was affected by the simple words of those washerwomen and the boatman. Similarly, here all these gyanis, they could have persisted and they could have said, no, all these simple things, you know, we want some Sanskrit nice analogies, but they actually surrendered to this Vishnu Chitta. So then the king announced in front of everyone, from today on, I declare that this Vishnu Chitta is my guru and I want to honor him in a royal procession. So he called for horses, he called for elephants, and then there was a procession in the kingdom where Vishnu Chitta was sitting on top of an elephant, and Vishnu Chitta is thinking, you know, I'm a simple man, what am I doing on an elephant? So he was feeling very much embarrassed, but it was a desire of the Supreme Lord, so he accepted it. So as this procession is going on and everyone is saying Vishnu Chitta ki jai, Vishnu Chitta ki jai, Vishnu Chitta is thinking, it is the Supreme Lord who sent me here. It is the Supreme Lord's glories which I spoke. So actually all this glory belongs to the Supreme Lord. I am just an empty vessel which is filled up with the mercy of the Lord. So the vessel should not be glorified, the contents of the vessel should be glorified. You know, when you go for prasadam after this class, we never look at the vessel, we look at the contents of the vessel. That is what is important. Is it not? So he was thinking, I am just an ordinary vessel, but I am filled with the mercy of the Lord. That is what made me. So as he's thinking like that, he looks in the sky. And much to his surprise, in the sky he sees Lakshmi and Narayan sitting on a Garuda. And they have also come to see how their great devotee Vishnu Chitta is being glorified by the Supreme Lord. So now what happens to this person, Vishnu Chitta? He is thinking, see, when I came to this debate, mostly all of them were not very much in favor of glorifying the Supreme Lord. They just wanted to show their greatness. So he said, in general, in this material world, people are more or less envious of the Supreme Lord. So he is thinking, Lakshmi and Narayan have come here. What must be going on in the hearts of the people who are seeing Lakshmi and Narayan? Mostly they will not have very good feelings for Lakshmi and Narayan. So usually people will go to the Supreme Lord for asking protection from the Supreme Lord. And you know what Vishnu Chitta did? Vishnu Chitta sang a song which is in Tamil language, it is called Tirupalandu. So Tirupalandu, Palandu means blessings. So he immediately composed a song in very simple language in Tamil, blessing the Lord with auspiciousness that, my dear Supreme Lord, you have appeared to give your darshan, but most people here are envious of you. Most people here are not your devotees. So, buri nazar lag jayegi aapko. To main aapko kuch aashirwad deta hoon. So, just see, many times, you know, this kind of a thought is expressed that there are two primary ways to have a relationship with the Supreme Lord. One is the Aishwarya Ras and one is the Madhurya Ras. So, Aishwarya is based on awareness of his opulence, awareness of his greatness. And Madhurya is more or less in forgetfulness of his greatness. So many times we speak how in South India, primarily it is Aishwarya mood. And in North India, especially in Ayodhya or especially in Vrindavan area, it is little bit of Madhurya, which includes Vatsalya, Sakya and Madhurya itself, Shringar Ras. But here we see how even in South India, although mostly acharyas and devotees, they are in a dasya ras, they are always in a servant mode. Here we see Vishnu Chitta, he is in vatsalya ras. The Supreme Lord blesses everyone, but here the devotee is blessing the Supreme Lord with auspiciousness. And then we'll tell you something about what happens ahead, which also again takes this idea more further. So from this day, when right in front of everyone he is blessing the Supreme Lord, Palandu, Palandu, like that he said, he got a name called Periya Alwar. So in the beginning we said how we are going to discuss about Alwars. Periya in that language means elderly. So why is he called Periya Alwar? He is called Periya Alwar because he is so elderly, he can bless the Supreme Lord also. He is really elderly. So this Periya Alwar, then he returned to his home and then one day he decided, all my life I have cultivated a flower garden. Why don't I offer a tulsi garland also to the Supreme Lord every day? And from that day onwards, in his garden, he reserved a small space for tulsi trees. One day as he was digging near the tulsi plant, he came across a very beautiful baby. It was a female baby. Just like in the Ramayana, Sita Devi was found from the ground. Similarly, this beautiful girl, she was effulgent. She was covered with soil and she was found near a tulsi tree. So he picked her up. It was very clear that she was divine. She was not of an ordinary origin. And he took her home and started raising her. One thing that Periya Alwar did with this baby is, he never ever chastised her. He never ever checked her because he knew she is of a divine origin. Slowly this girl started growing up. And she was also a very natural devotee of Krishna, just like her father. And she would sing many songs about Krishna. As she came to a youthful age, she became a young girl. She became exceptionally beautiful. So what she would do is, many times she would go in front of the mirror and spend long amount of time in front of the mirror and keep talking to herself. Am I sufficiently beautiful? Am I sufficiently beautiful? Am I really beautiful? Do I look beautiful today? So now many of us would get confused because we would think, actually we are supposed to get free from the bodily conception of life. So why is this devotee about whom we are talking spending so much time in front of the mirror? Darpan. Darpa jo arpan karta hai, usko bolte hai darpan. It gives us pride. So actually we should stay away from darpan. But this girl, like I mentioned, her father has Vatsalya Ras for the Supreme Lord. This girl had Madhurya Ras for the Supreme Lord. She would see herself as a lover of Krishna. Very rare in South India. In South India, usually what is propagated is Dasya Ras. Bhaiya, apne ko Bhagwan ka das ke roop mein hamesha samajna. Usually not many devotees in South India are in this relationship where they think of the Supreme Lord as their lover. But this girl would think. So she would dress herself very nicely and think, now when I go in front of Krishna, will Krishna be happy by seeing me? So one devotee was explaining how when we come to the temple, it is recommended that we come neat and clean. We should be clean shaven. We should have nice clean clothes. Now for most of us, when we talk of good clothes, we think of good clothes means fashionable clothes. No, there is a difference between good clothes and fashionable clothes. Good clothes means decent clothes. Good clothes means clean clothes. Good clothes means freshly washed clothes. And fashionable clothes means clothes that are as per the current commercial fashion. So Vaishnavas, when they dress nicely and they have a proper attitude, actually what they want to say is, when I go in front of Krishna, Krishna should be pleased to see me. So when he sees me unclean, when he sees that I don't even wash my clothes properly, he feels, is there something wrong in this devotee's life? Aisa kyun dukhi dukhi kyun lag raha hai? Aise mele mele kapde kyun pehen raha hai ye? So devotee should be clean. Devotee should be nicely well dressed when they come in front of the Supreme Lord. Think about a singer who's singing here. Will he just start singing? Chalo Bhagwan ke samne hum ga rahe hain, to Hare Krishna, something like that. No, any singer who sings in front of the Supreme Lord, if he's singing in front of the Supreme Lord for 15 minutes, he will practice at least for 1 hour at his home. Why? This is not an ordinary performance. He is not singing in front of his friends. He is singing in front of the Supreme Lord. This opportunity is once in a lifetime opportunity. I better practice nicely. So we have to practice nicely before singing in front of the Supreme Lord. Some of you, if you are interested in cooking and you want to cook something for the next festival, say Balram Purnima is the next festival, and we invite bhogas from the entire congregation. Any one of you can cook anything that you want and you can offer to Lord Balram on Balram Purnima. So now imagine, I have openly declared, kuch leke aayi hai aap apne ghar se. Now any one of you who is serious about pleasing the Supreme Lord, would you cook for the first time on that day? No. We'll cook at least 10 times before the same dish and perfect that dish. And then in a perfected state, we'll offer it to Lord Balaram. The best for the Supreme Lord. Nothing but the best. Similarly, this girl, she wanted to offer the best to the Supreme Lord. So she would dress the best. Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami in the Chaitanya Charitamrita describes, the gopis would dress very immaculately. They would spend hours and hours in front of the mirror. Why? Not to outshine other gopis. Not to have a competition with other gopis. Not to show how beautiful I am, because they knew when we go in front of Krishna, Krishna will be happy by looking at my beauty. So Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami says, the gopis would dress nicely, they would go in front of Krishna, Krishna would look at the beauty of the gopis, he would become happy, then Krishna would become happy, so that would increase the beauty of Krishna. Seeing the increased beauty of Krishna, the gopis would become more happy. And then when the gopis would become more happy, they would become more beautiful. And when they would become more beautiful, Krishna would become more happy, and so on. So Krishnadas Goswami says, Ei mata paraspara pade huda hudi, paraspara bade keha mukha nahi mudi. He uses this word called huda hudi. Huda hudi means competition. He says, in this way, when the gopis and Krishna would come in front of each other, there would be some kind of a transcendental competition. Who is more beautiful? Who is giving more happiness to the other person? So Vaishnavas, when they dress nicely, it is not to become fashionable. It is just so that they can offer a good bhoga offering. Not just of kirtan, not just of eating food, but also our face should be a nice bhoga offering. That's why, you know, there are these rules. If somebody leaves his body in our family, in general it is said, please don't come to the temple for 13 days. Bolta hai na, aisa bolta hai na. So one devotee asked me, somebody left in my family also, should I come to the temple? So we were discussing with him and we told him, in general you should not come. Why is it mentioned in general that if somebody leaves in your family you should not come? You know why? Because an ordinary person is a conditioned soul. He is too much affected when some loved one in the family leaves this world. So he is morose. He has a morose face. Such a person with a morose face, when he comes in front of Krishna and he is thinking about that loved one who has left this world and he has that morose face, actually, when we come in front of Krishna and when we understand who is Krishna, we can never be morose in front of Krishna. We can never be hopeless in front of Krishna. Here is the source of everything. Here is the Lord of everyone. How can we have a morose face in front of Krishna? That's why in general it is mentioned, aap bahut dukhi hai kya? Aapko bahut dukh lagta hai kya? Aap mat aaiye Bhagwan ke samne, because it's an insult to the Supreme Lord. Imagine you go in front of a rich person and you have a morose face. And the rich person says, kya chahiye tumko? Main kuch bhi de sakta hoon. Nahin. Are maango, jo chahiye maango. Nahin. Aap nahi de sakte mujhe. He says, you don't know who I am. Because you don't know who I am, that's why you have this morose face. Shoka shusagar vishoshana matyudaram. Third canto, Kapil Dev is describing, shok ke ashru ka agar sagar hai. Imagine an ocean that is made up of tears of lamentation. By meditating on the eyebrows of Krishna, the ocean of tears of lamentation can be evaporated. That is the beauty of Krishna, that is the power of Krishna. But if you are an ordinary conditioned soul and you cannot give up your moroseness, said, mat aiye. Thoda shant rahiye, thoda wo bhul jaiye, bhulne ke baad mein Bhagwan ke paas aiye. But if any one of you is a Vaishnav, any one of you understands, I lost a loved one, this is the time to pray to Krishna for that loved one. That loved one right now, most probably, you know, his fate, his or her fate is being decided, what kind of a body that person will get in the next life. This is the time to pray to Krishna, my dear Krishna, that living entity who left this world recently and is about to get a new body, please have unlimited mercy on that soul. I tried my best to connect him or her to you, but it was not possible. Wherever and whoever that person becomes in the next life, please give that person devotee association. Actually, if you can adjust your consciousness in that way, when somebody in your family leaves, that is the time to come and fall at the feet of Shri Radha Gopinath and spend hours and hours praying for that living entity. Jahan kahin bhi unka janam hoga, kripaya unko bhakto ka sang dijiye, kripaya unko Prabhupada ji ka ashray dijiye, kripaya apne prati akarshan dijiye. So here, this little girl is dressing herself to offer herself as bhoga to the Supreme Lord. And then one day she saw how her father makes a very nice, beautiful garland to be offered to Vatapatra Shai Vishnu. So she thought, how will this garland look on me? Because finally I am the wife of Krishna. So if I am the wife of Krishna and this garland is offered to Krishna, he'll offer it to me. So she put that garland around herself and she is looking at herself in the mirror. And she's thinking, oh, I look really beautiful. But then she thought, maybe my father will not appreciate it. So she removed the garland. And in this way, this was her new activity. Every day before the garland would be offered to Lord Vishnu's deity, she would put it around her neck. One day, one of her hairs got stuck in that garland. And Vishnu Chitta, as his daily affair, lifelong affair, he took that garland, which was worn by that girl, and he took it to be offered. So the pujari saw that hair. And the pujari said, see, you are such a Vaishnav, you are Vishnu Chitta. Pure jag mein aapki khyati hai. Aapko itna sa bhi niyam nahi malum. Jo cheez hum pehente hain, wo kabhi Bhagwan ko arpan nahi karte. Please never offer to Krishna something that we have used before. We should offer bhoga to Krishna and eat prasad, unless you are Shabri. But most of us are not Shabri. So he chastised Vishnu Chitta. Then Vishnu Chitta came home and looked at the hair. He said, this hair is not my hair. In those days, men had short hair. Long, long time back. Only females had long hair. So he looked at the hair and said, the only other person in my home who has this kind of long hair is not me, it is my daughter. So he called for his daughter and said, did you wear this garland? She accepted it. So why did you wear this garland? He says, because he's my husband. So this is very radical. Very radical for a young girl to say, Vishnu is my husband. But she was so sincerely speaking it, and she was so honestly, without any fear, very confidently. So he thought, better not to chastise. He made another garland and offered it to Vishnu. That night, the Supreme Lord, Vatapatra Shai, he came in the dreams of Periyarvar and said, I forbid you to offer me any garland that has not been offered to your daughter. From today onwards, it is my order to you, first you offer a garland to your daughter and then only you should offer it to me. So Periyarvar is thinking, what is this going on? Ye to pura niyam ko ulta ho raha hai. But one thing he realized, my daughter is for real. I was thinking she is some kind of a, some delusion girl who has some strange ideas, but no, Vishnu is saying like this. So he accepted that. And in this way, he would make a garland, his daughter would wear it, and then it would be offered to the Supreme Lord. As she grew up more, it was now her marriage age. So he said, see, all your love for Krishna and Vishnu is very nice. I really have respect for you. But now it is time for you to marry some suitable young boy. So whom would you marry? So very honestly, she said, if you marry me to any mortal, I will die. In my heart, I have already accepted Lord Vishnu as my husband. I cannot think of marrying somebody else. So then the reality dawned upon Periyarvar. So she's serious. But how to arrange a marriage of Vishnu and this girl? This has never happened before. So she said, tell me something more about Lord Vishnu. So in Sri Vaishnavas, there is a concept of Divya Desham. There are 108 Divya Deshams. The 108th Divya Desham is Vaikuntha. 107 Divya Deshams are on earth planet. So he started speaking the names of each of those deities. So in each Divya Desham, there is a Vishnu deity. And it is one of the desires of Sripad Ramanujacharya, their Acharya, that every bona fide Sri Vaishnav in his whole life should visit all the 107 Divya Deshams. So he started speaking the names of all those deities. And when he came to the name Ranganath, Ranganath is the name of Vishnu in Sri Rangam. So Sri Rangam, Ranganath. What is the meaning of Ranganath? Ranga in that language means an assembly. So Ranganath means the greatest in any assembly. Whether it is an assembly of human beings, whether it is an assembly of demigods, whether it is an assembly of anybody, always the greatest person is Vishnu, he is Ranganath. So when he spoke the word Ranganath, the daughter said, I want to marry Ranganath. So he said, now this is a big thing. Vatapatra Shahi hote to humare hi gao ke hai. Unko apne kaise mana leta. Now Sri Rangam happens to be the headquarters of the Sri Sampraday. There's the most prominent deity of the Sri Vaishnavas. So it's very difficult for me. But that night, again, the Supreme Lord came in the dreams of Periyarvar. And he said, don't worry. I will send a marriage proposal. As a groom of your daughter, I'll send a marriage proposal. If the marriage proposal comes, you get ready. And that night he appeared in the dreams of the head pujari of Sri Rangam temple and told him, I want to marry such and such girl in Sri Viliputtur. She is the daughter of a person called Vishnu Chitta, Periyarvar, and you please arrange for a nice palanquin. And he appeared, the same Lord appeared in the dreams of the king. What was the name of the king? Vallabhdev. So Vallabhdev ke sapne mein aur bole, I entrust you to make a very beautiful palanquin. So it is mentioned, a new palanquin was made, entirely studded with pearls, very costly pearls. And this palanquin was sent to Periyadavar, and this very beautiful girl, she was put in that palanquin, covered from all sides, and accompanied by brahmanas, soldiers of the king and so on, from Srivilliputtur village. Andal, that is the name of this girl, Andal, and she and her father, they came to Srirangam, and that palanquin stopped right in front of the main temple. And as soon as it stopped in front of the temple, Andal stepped out. She could feel, I am right there, very close to the Lord of my heart. And in front of everyone's eyes, she just rushed straight to the main altar. So if you have been to Srirangam, the Supreme Lord there is Sheshashayi. Sheshashayi means he is not standing, he is resting on Anantashesha. He is in a sleeping posture. So just like husband and wife recline on the same bed together. So Andal, she just rushed straight to the altar, and before anyone could say anything, she also reclined on Anantashesha just next to Vishnu, and she embraced Vishnu, and right in front of everyone's eyes, she merged into the deity of Lord Vishnu to accompany him in the spiritual world. So it is mentioned this Andal, she is non-different from Sita Devi, and that's why she also appeared in the same way, and then now she again went back to accompany the Supreme Lord as his wife in the spiritual world. So she is the only female Alwar. Out of the 12 Alwars, 11 are male, and she is the 12th one who is female. It is mentioned she wrote a poem called Tirupavai. Now I may be a little wrong in my pronunciations, I am really sorry for that, but this Tirupavai is a very famous poem in which she prays to the Supreme Lord in the mood of a gopi. So this Madhurya Ras is almost absent in South India, is almost absent in the Sri Vaishnava tradition, but in the form of Andal, even that Madhurya Ras, you know, a small reference is made to the Madhurya Ras, and it's a very beautiful poem where she is calling out to Krishna, oh my dear Krishna, please come, all of us are waiting for you. And many times in the childhood days, she and some of her friends, they would imitate the pastimes of Krishna. Just like in the Ras Leela, when Krishna left the Ras Leela, all the gopis imitated some of the pastimes. So similarly, Andal would imitate some of the pastimes. So she had that kind of a conjugal relationship with Krishna. So I just thought that we can discuss something about these Alvars in the Sri Vaishnava tradition and learn a little bit from them. So we discussed about two Alvars, Periya Alvar and Andal Alvar. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Ananta Koti Vaishnava Vrind ki jai, Andal Alvar ki jai. So we'll have Kirtan now, and then there is Mahaprasad for everyone. Thank you very much. Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shiva Sadi Gaur Bhakta Brahma. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare,
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna,
Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare,
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna.